Well, hello everybody and welcome to another Master Chef's web show. And this is the second of our candidates' reviews. We're about to have round 10 today. I think it's round 10. So we're going to look at the decisive games that have taken place in the interim since our first review. And the games are, let's just get the screen share up here. The games are Rapport against Duda, Nepniachtchi against Duda. So Duda is appearing regularly in the runners-up category. Faruja against Rapport and Rajabov against Nakamura, which was a big blow for Nakamura fans because people were hopeful that he would get into the frame. So shall we take it away with Rapport against Duda?
Yeah, we can do that. And good morning, everybody, or wherever you are in the world, whichever part of the day you are experiencing. Hello. Rapport versus Duda. Yes, this could well be a thriller because they're actually propping up the table. They've got everything to play for. They've got to try and win. At the moment, after nine rounds, Duda is in last place with 3 points. And then Rapport has got 4 points. But even those scores are not too bad, are they? 4 points out of nine. I mean, that's not too bad, is it, Nigel?
Yeah, it's pretty good. I mean, the thing is, when they've still got five rounds left, an awful lot can happen. I mean, if somebody like, you know, Ding suddenly notches up three wins, then he's in the frame, you know. And they after Nepniachtchi, you know, who's on plus four, and they're all pretty tightly bunched.
Yeah.
And, you know, you just need one or two surprise results. You know, somebody to not, you know, notch up two, three wins in succession and everything changes.
Well, the thing about Rapport is you're always going to get some sharp chess from him or something slightly offbeat or different to the norm. And sure enough, in this game, he starts off with what looks like a dull opening, the four knights.
Yeah.
But now plays something a bit unusual, but which is not too bad, g3.
Yeah.
Now, the thing about this position is, for a long time, bishop b5 was thought to be more or less the only move to try and give white any sort of chances here. And, of course, bishop c4 is played frequently among beginners, school children, who are told just to develop the pieces. But then black's got the fork trick, knight takes e4, which takes all the fun out of playing that variation for white. These days, however, a lot of white players are playing around with this position, aren't they, Nigel? They're playing all sorts of different things. I've seen A3 here. I've seen A4. And here we have G3. And I think this is named after the Grandmaster Igel Gleck, isn't it?
Yeah. He's been the pioneer of G3 and was playing it pretty much all the time. I do want to mention, just after bishop c4, knight takes e4, there are some spectacular traps in this position. For example, d5, you can then play
knight fg5.
Knight fg5 check, king here, and then
queen f3, go for it.
Queen f3. And black has to be pretty careful in this situation. If he goes queen e8, then he suddenly gets... Does he get hit by some... what does he get hit by here?
Well, knight c3 doesn't look too bad.
Yeah, knight c3 is very good, isn't it? So I think the only move is actually queen d7.
Yeah,
it's a good move, but it's the only move. Right. And so you can imagine that all the 8-year-olds watching this show may want to give this a try because your opponent may well go wrong in this situation. And not many people are going to find queen d7. You know, so it's it's very complicated. I also wanted to point out that after bishop c5, then the fork trick does not work because there is a counter fork like this.
Oh dear.
Because of the move g3. this is all very entertaining and of great value for those who like to play their nights out and get castle quickly.
Well, I'm sure anybody who's playing in the candidates watching this show will now realise that they're cut down a lot of their preparation by watching this
show. So, yeah, so G3, Bishop C5 is, I think it's thought to be the best move, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's interesting to compare it, if we just go back to the start with this variation, in the Vienna, where White plays G3. This is, again, a... quite an interesting way to play with white, and you can play it against knight f6 or you can play it against knight c6. Of course, the difference is that white's left his f pawn unobstructed. So quite often he puts the knight on g1 or e2 and manages to get f4 in. Yeah. I think that way round, it's perhaps slightly more dynamic than Gleck's method because white's blocked his f pawn. But it's just an invitation to a slightly different type of game, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think it's well worth considering. You know, when you realise how much there is to other openings. Also, the big advantage of the four knights is that you can basically sidestep the dreaded Petrov. So if they play knight f6 here, you just go knight c3 as Rapport did. In fact, he was probably dreading a Petrov, and that's why he had prepared this.
Well, again, if you're dreading the Petrov, you can also play the Vienna if you intend to play the four knights game.
Yeah,
that might be an even more reliable way of getting into it.
Yeah,
because what is black to do here? I mean, bishop c5 and bishop b4, not that great. So you're down to moving one of your knights.
Yeah,
all these sorts of move order tricks are quite interesting to contemplate, aren't they?
Oh yeah,
and now we come to quite an interesting moment in the game here because Black plays a move, which I'm sure will, you know, make a lot of players sit up and take notice. What is that all about? Well, the thing is that I think White might be threatening some sort of positional move like knight to a4, which actually is known in the Vienna. And Black often plays a move like a6 here to stop it, something like that, or a5 as played in the game. But the whole idea is that if Black castles, can White now play knight a4 and nab the bishop?
Yeah, but I believe he can. This is one of the points to this line, and people have just habitually played pawn to a6 in order to preserve the bishop. But Duda obviously decided that a5 was better, or maybe his engine told him that pawn to a5 was gained space for black on the queen side. So the engine.
Well, white is getting that bishop.
Yeah.
Hence the move a5. Yeah, maybe that's useful later on because, you know, later on White might want to expand with the move B4. And Now, of course, he can't, or he's dissuaded from doing so. So this is an interesting move. Of course, Black ceding the B5 square, isn't he? But I don't think White can make much use of it.
Yeah, yeah. It's
So White just castles.
I was fascinated by Duda's eighth move, actually.
Well, let's carry on then. He plays... H6.
Yeah.
B3. That's a blinking strange move, isn't it?
I was astonished by B3. And then he puts his bishop on E3 later.
I mean, is he so afraid of A4 by black?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it doesn't seem to be the kind of thing we should be petrified of, but...
I mean, what's an alternative? I suppose H3 is a decent move here, isn't it?
Yeah, h3, intending bishop e3.
And then does black go a4, I guess that?
Well, I'd have thought then you go bishop e3.
Bishop e3, wow. Are you sure about that?
Well, I would have thought so. It's the standard plan.
Yeah, I mean, it does not look very dangerous at all.
And then we go, what?
Knight h4.
Knight h4, probably. I mean, I'm still not convinced by what this pawn is doing on a4.
Well, all right, then. I'll push it forward.
Now I'll play b3.
Yeah, I mean, I must say it looks nicer for white.
Yeah, yeah.
But your bishop's a pile of you can append the last word at your
well, we might always get it into play after going knight f5. If black takes, then we can play ef potentially.
You can certainly do that, yeah.
Is
it, but b3, it's a strange move, isn't it?
It's just really strange.
Has it ever been played before?
No game found.
So already we're in kind of original territory.
Yeah, after a mere 8 moves.
Which probably suited both of them. You know, both of them need a win. So, you know, why not create something different?
Well, I think that Rapport, he's probably aware that Duda is a very well-prepared player.
Yeah.
And Rapport likes to improvise. So maybe he played B3 as a move which doesn't lack points. But, can also avoid any preparation. I think this is one of the things that they're doing now, is they're playing like the third or fourth best move, which I tend to do just naturally, unless it's like the 20th best move, in order to sidestep their opponent's preparation.
I mean, the thing is that it must also be said that despite the fact that all the pieces on the board, this is not a very interesting position. I mean, it's hardly the sharpest tool in the box, this sort of stuff.
It might liven up.
Knight d4 is a good move because it actually takes advantage of this move b3, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Kind of points the finger at it. If white takes, bishop takes, and suddenly the knight's pinned.
Yeah.
So he plays bishop e3, offering exchanges, and black just plays a solid move there.
Yeah, it looks like Duda is just playing very well and has got maybe even slightly the better of it already.
Yeah, it's not a great advert for white's opening. I think if you want to play this sort of stuff with white, you've simply got to get f4 in quite early.
Move two.
Well, via the Vienna or something, but this is a little bit insipid. So now he plays a3. He's running out of pawns to push, but he can push that one. Okay.
Oh, so, c-pawn at home.
Yeah. Okay, what's the point of that? Just a defensive move, I guess. So now black swaps off, keeps trading.
Yeah, and now the
I actually don't know many people who would take with a pawn, I have to say.
Yeah. But he's going to make the game more interesting.
Well, you could go d4 in a position like this, couldn't you?
Well, maybe.
Or even f4.
Isn't black playing d5 here already?
Well, he may well be, unfortunately, for white. I think that's probably the answer, isn't it?
Yeah.
Probably why he didn't do it.
So, I mean, f takes e3. He's again managing to unbalance the game and give himself some chances. I mean, you know, I think potentially if somebody's got a lot of energy, they might do well in these closing rounds.
Yeah. All the same, it doesn't look like very much for white at all. I mean, where's the kingside attack coming from? g4, move the queen and then double rooks or what?
You would need a lot of free moves to get it working.
Four free moves.
Yeah, so you play rook f2, rook g1, g4, knight e2 to g3.
Or queen g3 or something like that.
Yeah, queen g3 and bishop f3 and then h4 and then g5. But that takes an awfully long time. And meanwhile, black's just going to do something.
Well, he did something.
Yeah.
And one of the most interesting points about that move is it allows the rook to come into play to defend the kingside.
Yeah.
So queen to g3, as expected. So he's revving up for h4 and g5, perhaps, or maybe g5 straight away. And now this move. Wow.
Yeah. That's quite an extraordinary move, actually. I mean, in the old days, we were told, you know, that we shouldn't advance pawns on the side we're being attacked.
Yeah.
That we should just stay where we are. You know, but I mean, you know, the modern era is all about computer generated A5 and H5 moves. So,
well, I mean, surely if black wants to defend himself and just play solidly, you could go there, Connie.
Well, I would have thought so.
And just say, what are you doing?
Yeah, and look for a counter blow in the center.
I mean, I guess white does something like that. And now we just need a move in the middle.
Yeah.
Okay, it's not that easy. But
I might have been inclined not to play rook a7, actually, instead just to play, say, bishop e6, and then just go on with b4.
Yeah, then d5 after that.
Sorry?
Well, you go b4, nudging the way the knight, then you can play d5, can't you?
Yeah. And or play on the a-file and try and get the queen in on the a-file.
I mean, this looks very reasonable. White to get an attack, as you say, is going to require quite a few moves, preparatory moves. And so, yeah, you just kick white around a bit with b4.
Yeah.
Maybe he plays b4 himself, but then you go d5, don't you?
Yeah.
I mean, that looks really sensible.
Yeah, or you draw the rook away with ab and trade on a1. You know, and there's certainly no attack for white there.
I mean, I don't know whether Duda must feel he's off form in this tournament. You know, is he thinking that he's off form and so he plays poorly? I don't know. 3 out of 9 against these players. Well, is that off form? I don't know.
I don't know if it is. I mean, I think that...
Well, he hasn't won a game yet. I mean, I think that's the... Out of 9 rounds, he's drawn 6 games and lost 3. So...
He's not got that much experience in events at this level. I think that's worth... pointing out.
Well, this is his idea, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it looks dodgy. Takes knight a7. This is the idea. The knight, the pawn is pinned.
Yeah.
White
Stockfish still likes his position at this stage.
And now black takes with the knight.
Yeah, some of us might have been inclined to take with the queen there.
Is that reasonable? I mean, it looks okay.
But maybe knight takes, you know, gives black some chances of trying to exploit white's weakened king position.
So here we see white getting rid of his bad bishop. And now there's an intermezzo, Zwischenzug, where white threatens mate.
Yeah. And the...
And now an incredible move, this knight g5.
Yeah. Which looks kind of strange, because you wonder if black is going to be in danger on the h-file now.
Well, that is the issue, isn't it? I mean, I suppose he could just go g6, couldn't he? And now white's got to take an h3 with something. Now, it's interesting to think about what.
And in any case, black will play knight f6 to h5. And then, you know, he can bolster his king in additional ways as well. King h7 and...
Right, the queen, maybe.
Yeah. So knight f6. Oh, hang on, there's h5. Sorry, I missed that.
Yeah.
Right, so not knight f6. So instead...
Well, queen d7 is a move, isn't it?
Yeah, queen d7. Even queen c8. Queen d7.
It doesn't look that scary for black, to be honest.
Yeah. No, he should have plenty of defensive resources here. But my impression is that he gave white unnecessary chances by trying to be so clever on the king side.
I think he's trying to win.
Yeah.
And
understandable, wants to get back in it.
Yeah. So sorry for the mouse flick there. So knight g5 takes, bishop now goes back. But as you say, of course, now there could be issues on the h file.
Yeah.
And this allows rook a7, another strange move.
Well, yeah, and then white goes queen f3, and apparently rook f1 would be a very strong move there. Queen f3 also leaves black with major issues about what he does to defend the h-file.
Black has gone wrong, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
That knight g5 move was a bit too optimistic. Now white's got a terrific attack. I mean, that is a kind of nondescript move. Is he playing rook e6 or what?
Well, presumably. That looks awful.
Yeah. Nervy sort of move.
Yeah.
And Rook H1 is... And now F5. Wow, this is...
Well, I think he's in desperate straits already. White is threatening just to play King G1 and then Queen F6, for example.
You have to say that both players look as though they're off form.
Well, I don't know. I mean, Rapport, he seems to be in decent shape. Duda, I think he's someone that likes the initiative very much. And here he clearly hasn't had it. Rapport was quite clever in just making sure that Duda's got no theory as a backdrop. Because I think a lot of the top players now are quite heavily reliant on being able to follow their preparation. If they're not in their preparation, then funny things happen. And I think this is one of the things that Magnus Carlsen has been able to exploit so effectively, that he just finds ways of throwing them out early on.
Mm. Well, White is simply threatening to checkmate Black on the H-file. So, King G1, Rook H2, or maybe there's a Queen F6 somewhere if Black allows it. It's very unfortunate for Black, but maybe he's got to just push his F-pawn up one square or two squares. I mean, F6 is suggested by Stockfish, but it doesn't look that great.
Well, still winning for White. King G1.
It's horrible.
Yeah.
So it's all gone wrong. Maybe that knight g5 was simply too clever.
Yeah.
So rook h1, f5, and now king g1. Why take? The pawn on g5 is like a bone in Black's throat. B4 looks kind of irrelevant, really. And now report takes on f5.
Yeah.
So if Black takes the knight...
Black takes the knight, I imagine.
Do we just go Queen H3? Mate on a.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's
Queen H8, Queen F6, and Rook H8.
Yeah.
Don't think he's coming back from that one.
No.
So he must recapture. And now this super move.
Yeah. End of game.
Yeah, you give somebody. Any one of these players, the slightest sniff of a tactical opportunity, and that is what happens. He pounces on it and finishes him off.
Yeah. So the so if takes.
So Black resigned.
Yeah.
Obviously, knight f6 is a devastating threat. So he probably has to take.
Yeah.
And now.
We play Queen H5.
Or Queen H5, yeah.
Queen H5.
Doesn't look too easy for Black.
And then... Is that right? Rook G7.
Okay, we go check.
Or do we go G6?
Well, this is not bad.
But it's coming out.
Well, let him come out. We'll take all his pieces off.
Right, rook f2 check. That's good enough, isn't it? Or we can do g6. Yeah.
You're always looking for the best way.
Yeah, so the resignation was understandable. And,
I mean... What an unusual game for this level of competition.
Yeah. a weird homemade opening, followed by Black... doing some strange stuff on the king side. Vladimir Kramnik apparently has said that this is the lowest quality of play he's ever seen in a candidates tournament, and he thinks it's because the players were playing too much blitz during the COVID saga.
It's possible.
Right, so now we've got Ian Nepanyachi, and we've got poor old Duda playing on the receiving end once again.
Of knight f3 and g3. I'm not sure that's the best way to describe it. You can't be on the receiving end of knight f3 and g3.
Well, I think it's quite noteworthy that Rapport and Nepanyachi have both gone the anti-theory route against Duda.
Yeah, I mean, I think Nepomniachtchi is just hoping to just completely outplay him, isn't he? Just forget about theory, just play a solid position.
Yeah.
And of course,
be working quite well. Plus four in this field.
Anybody who plays this variation with white, this line, the Reti and knight f3 and g3, will know the bishop g4 is one of the biggest challenges. How do you get advantage against this system? It's not that easy. Having said that, this move e6 is a little bit unusual.
Oh, yeah, normally they go like d7, don't they?
Or c6.
Yeah.
You know, this is the New York system, isn't it?
Yeah.
Capablanca's stuff. And then knight d7 was Kerry's move, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I believe that's the Kerry's variation. I've tried this stuff with white countless times.
Well, me too.
Usually
I don't get an advantage against any of black's lines.
Curiously enough, online, they all play this in blitz.
Right. You know,
this bishop g4 stuff and just set up the triangle and, you know, try and beat you on time. Usual sort of stuff. slightly unusual to see this move so early. Normally, black would play c6 here. So white's got to choose a way to try and get some more.
Now, white doesn't go c4 because a bishop takes f3. I think that's probably worth mentioning.
Yeah, point that out. Go for it then.
Bishop takes f3, knight e5.
Yeah.
Attacking this pawn on c4 and threatening to mangle white's pawns over here.
That's worth knowing.
You have to end. Well, this is probably also really bad. Black may even take our pawn now.
It looks ghastly.
I'm sure it is. So, that's one of the traps you need to avoid when playing the anemic parsnip attack with white.
So h3. Yeah. And now black can even take the knight.
He can even take the knight.
And just play c6 and then sit there with this pawn chain and laugh at you. But he goes bishop h5.
Yeah. And then
and now this move d4.
Yeah, it's interesting because in
Kramnik win a splendid game with this. Was it against Beliavsky? Knight bd2.
Well, a few people have won splendid games. I think Elianov beat Karyakin in a line like this, and it's become quite popular. Right, that they just go d4 with white.
I love the way Stockfish gives this as a dubious move. Absolutely ridiculous. we expect white to play c4. That's the usual.
That's what we've become accustomed to. Except that in that position, black can still play bishop takes f3.
Hang on a minute. You mean here?
Yeah. If you go.
Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. All right. So here we go.
Yeah. Now he does it.
The pawn triangle arrives.
Yeah. And now white takes on d5. Very importantly, he does it only when black's knight's on d7. You don't want that knight going to c6 when you do this kind of thing.
Take back.
Yeah.
And now, interesting move again, knight e5.
Yeah. And Stockfish awards this an X-Slam. I don't know.
It's all too easy with white just to shovel out a move like knight c3. But that wouldn't lead you very far, because what is the knight actually doing on c3?
Yeah, and black would then play bishop d6 and prevent knight e5.
So the knight comes in. Now, does black have to take it? He did, but does he have to take it?
Well, if he doesn't, then it's...
Can I not go bishop d6?
F4 anyway.
Are you really going to go f4?
Oh, yeah. Intending g4.
Yeah.
H5 is wondering about its future already.
Doesn't have a future if you play g4.
So it's
okay. So that is the idea.
Yeah.
Quite effective.
Oh yeah, it's primitive but effective.
So he takes the knight.
Yeah.
Take back knight d4. Aha. And it looks as though, you know, White's going nowhere in this position.
Except after Bishop H5 being in a state of, you know,
oh,
it's seriously offside. So again, he's a tempo on it with Rook C1.
Yeah. Defend.
Queen E7, King H2.
Right, so here's the first sign that White is intending to advance the kingside pawns.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like much, but that bishop on H5, as Nigel says, is in a very strange spot.
Black can liberate it with F6, but that weakens his kingside. And if he tries H6, then the bishop may end up just out of play on H7 for all eternity.
Well, he can't really play F6 straight away. He needs to castle first, doesn't he? Because the bishop on C5 would hang if he took back with the queen.
Yeah, yeah. Unless
you really don't want to take back with a pawn. So castles.
But you won't be able to take with the rook because of bishop G5.
Well, then you can't play F6 anyway. But he played G4.
Yeah.
Which Stockfish thinks White should preface that move with A3. Presumably to stop bishop b4 at some point. G4 is played. Bishop comes back. F4. Here we go. H6. And now White just masses his pieces, getting ready for a kingside pawn avalanche.
Yeah.
This is an instructive game in many ways, isn't it? Because it looks as though White's got absolutely nothing, but he manages to conjure up nothing less than a really strong attack.
Well, he's got a pawn majority. Kingside pawn majority, which needs to be pushed.
And it gets pushed.
And Black gets pushed back.
So Black is just centralising his pieces and hoping that this will be enough. On we go.
HG. So he opens the H file again. same error that he played against Rapport. I mean, do you think there's like a consensus amongst these guys that the way to beat Duda is to go anti-theory and then shove your kingside pawns forward?
I don't know. From these two games, it would seem so. he doesn't look comfortable defending a position like this.
No.
Well, I know a lot of people who would take that pawn. What am I saying? G5 here.
Yeah,
I know a lot of people who would take that pawn, but maybe King H8, as the machine suggests.
Well, King H8, you would think that you want to make it as hard as possible for White to open files on the king side. You know, that again is like an old school thing.
Well, it's less easy for White now, isn't it?
Yeah, he's going to have a much harder job to, you know, to generate an attack.
I mean, I guess you could just play a move like this to stop any sort of attempt at simplification.
Yeah.
And keep the game going. But Black's king is safer on H8 than it is on G8, that's for sure. And after H takes G5, well, of course, Black can hardly put his king on H8 at all now.
Yeah.
That's the problem, isn't it?
Yeah, and there's a long-term issue. I mean, how long is it going to take White to play some rook H1 and queen H4? I mean, I think this move is designed to try and prevent a primitive attack on the H file.
Yeah, but it's just asking for trouble, allowing that.
So F5 now looks horrendous because White's going to play G6.
And does.
He does indeed.
Much to Stockfish's annoyance. Well, he plays E6 first.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the pawn on B2 is kind of irrelevant. White has suddenly conjured up too many threats. He takes G6. Doesn't like that one.
Yeah, he wants to go rook B1 as A's Vishenzug.
Yeah, and if he takes this, then G6.
Yeah.
Is the difference being you get a rook takes B7 at some point?
Yeah, presumably.
Well, G6, that's a very human move, you know. He sees a bishop. He takes a bishop.
I would have gone for the bishop.
King H8, who would have thought it? The king finds sanctuary for a fleeting moment. How many pawns has he got? Three pawns, but not for long.
Well, he's still got them when he goes rook takes e2, but that is apparently not a good thing either, because now rook takes f5. Happens.
God. Yeah, this is not very pleasant, is it? But I've got to give a check.
Can't take the rook because of mate on g7. Black goes rook takes a2.
Well, is there anything else he can play? I guess queen c1 check is answered by rook f1, is it?
Don't see why not.
And then queen c5 check, just move the king, and I'm threatening mate, so...
Yeah, king h1 is
the baton passes to white then, and the white will have the attack. Yeah. I mean, I guess the other move is probably something like double up. And then gets to go here, apparently, ignoring it.
Yeah, because rook e1 check.
Bishop f1, are you?
Bishop f1.
Yeah, white's threats are pretty strong, aren't they? Let's have a look at that. So, here, bishop f1. Yeah, it's a pretty effective covering of the king, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. So it's...
Well, rook takes a2, he went.
Yeah.
This one. Now, does that threaten some cleanup operation?
It seems to be threatening rook g5, from what I can tell.
Check.
Yeah, bishop f1. And then rook g5.
It's nice, I have to say. Just highlighting that, you know, actually black doesn't have much counterplay at all.
Yeah.
White's rooks are doing a sterling job, both defending and attacking at the same time.
Yeah. The pawn on h7 is useful in stopping any rook g8.
And now he just goes there. Very nice.
Yeah.
Threatening not a lot. Look here.
And black resigned. Well, what a... said and an amazingly... I mean, I thought that game was actually very simple in many respects.
It was thematic, wasn't it?
Yeah. He got a kingside pawn majority and right out of the opening and then pushed it. And black probably didn't respond in the most tenacious way because he opened the h-file.
It's a good lesson for flank opening practitioners, because we've all struggled to get something out of a position like this one.
It has received but some attention.
It shows the way.
Yeah, d4 and c4 has received quite a bit of attention of late.
And who would think that in this position, you know, white could get a really strong kingside attack. But it's so important that the bishop on... And maybe bishop c5 is a mistake.
Yeah, maybe.
Having said that, what does he play?
A really early f6.
Looks pretty dubious, doesn't it? I mean, I don't know. Do I start with queen b3?
You may well do.
Then e2's hanging.
Yeah, but then rook e1. Just let it fall. So queen b3. Queen b3 is pretty good. Looks like.
And white's working up an edge.
Yeah.
Which I suppose bishop c5 was designed to meet.
But he's pinning, he's developing a piece and pinning the f2 pawn.
Yeah, but of course, this is by no means, you know, this is not anything like as dangerous anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, black could play queen b6 to start off with, couldn't he?
Yeah. So you so the rook c1 and then king h2 makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
You're just getting ready to...
those pawns.
Yeah.
Ah, okay. Interesting game. That was genuinely interesting. And let's move on to the next classic encounter.
This was a very interesting game, I thought.
Ali Reza.
Faruja sacrifices a pawn in the opening, as we shall see.
There's a pattern emerging. Rapport and Duda are featuring in all the decisive games.
For the last one.
And Roy Lopez on the board.
Yeah.
Thought we have a Marshall Gambit. No.
No, it's a Berlin. An attempted but sidestepped Berlin. Because now he goes D3. So this has become like the mainline theory now. And I'm still surprised they're all playing Bishop C5 like on autopilot.
Will you excuse me while I go and
perfectly
take a caffeine tablet?
Knight D4, trading a knight.
Trading, yeah, knight A3.
Yeah, so knight A3, C6, bishop A4, D6. And black's position looks rock solid at this stage.
Totally reasonable.
Bishop B3. And now black goes queen E7. And of course, Stockfish advocates A5 in this position because it always likes pushing its A-pawn. I think Stockfish is behind all this A4, A5 stuff.
I'll take your word for it.
Well, I don't know for sure, but since the rise of computers, people have been pushing their A-pawns like crazy, as
all the A-pawns.
As Duda did against Rapport, A5, not A6. So black now goes queen E7. And white plays knight C4. Bishop G4 doesn't like that either. I can understand bishop C7. And then white's idea is that he's going to play F4.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's why he didn't do it, isn't it? Not F3, excuse me.
F4. F3 has been played, which astonishes me.
No, I think I just played that.
Oh, right, okay.
It has been played, but in the last 2 minutes. Well, bishop G4 is kind of understandable.
Bishop C7. No, F3 has been played. Oh, no. Really? No, it was you. I think it was you.
It was me.
Yeah. We'll just get rid of that F3. So F4. White's got some initiative now.
Yeah.
So that explains why the adventurous bishop G4 was played. White just goes queen E1, getting ready to hoik his queen over to the king side if necessary after F4. Bishop C5, king H1.
Getting ready for F4.
Building up for F4 or even F3 first. Pawn to A5. And white now plays pawn to f4, which looks like a totally appropriate response to the irrelevant push of black's a pawn.
Well, he keeps on pushing it.
Yeah, he keeps on going, driving white's pieces more or less where they want to go
to better squares.
And this is where we get this this pawn sack.
Does he need to do that?
I would be tempted just to put the knight on e3.
Yeah, what's wrong with knight e3? It just looks
nothing
maybe,
wrong with knight.
Maybe it's just knight takes e5 is better, but knight e3 certainly comes to mind as a really good move.
Yeah.
Well, you're threatening rook takes f6, aren't you, for starters?
You are indeed.
And knight f5.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, he thought this was better.
Well, it looks very dangerous, and black is probably obliged to take this. Now, apparently bishop d2 is better than bishop e3. Bishop e3, of course, looks supernatural. And queen takes b2, queen f2.
So if castles, bishop d4 is the end.
Or e5, knight moves, bishop takes h7 check. E5.
Queen takes e5, that's
yeah, right. Yeah, queen takes e5.
But so bishop d4.
Bishop d4, yeah.
Of course, if he castles queenside, he's probably playing in the wrong tournament.
That's a Stockfish recommendation. So... So we end up with a situation very shortly in which Rapport has his king stuck in the center. One of the weird things I found was in a few moves time, we had rook a c1, rook d8, and now Stockfish prefers black.
Really?
Yeah. And it says white has got, it's got h3 as the best move, just stopping knight g4, presumably, and only a slight disadvantage for white. The move bishop b1 is like much worse for white. Now I wouldn't even consider assessing a position like this. I personally would just wouldn't want to play black because you can't get castled.
Yes. Well, I mean, first of all, is bishop takes f6 possible?
I'm sure it is.
I mean, I guess black is okay there after rook g8. Takes, rook g8.
Yeah. I mean, but bishop c5 looks like just long-term development issues for black because he cannot castle.
Yeah.
I mean, in the old days, we were told that we should try and get castled and connect the rooks. When you can't get castled and you can't connect your rooks and it's move 22 already, then you have to start to wonder about about how bad black's position is.
I mean, could I go here straight away? Rook AD1. You can't castle.
Yeah, probably, but well, you might end up castling anyway, just to
get bishop c5. You give the exchange.
I know. It might be the best chance.
Yeah. I mean, I've also got queen g3 after that. That was one of the ideas.
Yeah, and then do we tough up with knight e8?
Yeah, you can do.
You got two pawns for the exchange. I would be very relieved to give up two pawns and be able to castle. Sorry, give
then
up.
What did white do wrong?
What did black do wrong?
No, white. It gives us an exclamation mark. What has white done wrong if it gives black as?
Well, I think the assessment's just wrong. I think the computer assessment is just, just silly.
And now it just gives h3.
I mean, white has got his two pawns down here, and the engine is giving him as almost equal.
But he's got an extra rook in play.
I know. I mean, I would have just said white is clearly better, and I wouldn't touch black's position with a barge pole, to be honest.
Hmm. Well, I'm sure that's what most humans would also do. I agree with that. And then if he comes in here, apparently this.
Yeah. And the king still cannot castle. We're probably on the verge of being able to.
So you give this, it up.
I would hang on the e5 now, isn't it? Oh, bishop takes a4. Why can't he play? Oh, he still can't. He black just takes it, of course.
Okay, we're heading into.
Well, this looks all
side of chess.
Yeah, this looks all wrong. because h3 looks all wrong. I mean, I like Ferrugia's move much more because he's not allowing rook d2.
So queen e5, back at the game, queen h4.
Yeah, and black still cannot castle.
Bishop c4. Again,
that's
the understandable move.
Stockfish move, rook d7. But black has not castled.
Well, you've still got to get through.
Oh, yeah, but, you know, as long as black can't get his king safe, we might do, like, h3 now, perhaps.
Yeah, that looks sensible, doesn't it?
Just to take g4 away.
And the game continues.
Yeah.
Well, back at the game, he plays bishop c4, which, again, is entirely understandable. And now white plays rook f5. In comes the queen, attacking the rook. And now rook g1.
Yeah, and the engine doesn't like rook g1 one bit.
And now it starts to get very hairy, of course.
Yeah, well, the threat is queen takes g7, not to mention the queen coming into c7.
So if bishop takes f5 here?
Well, just ef.
Just pawn takes bishop.
Yeah.
With numerous threats.
Yeah. I'm bringing the rook to the e-file check, and rook e7 check, and queen c7 mate.
Yes, it looks very unpleasant for black. So he goes knight d7.
Yeah.
Bishop d6.
Now bishop takes f5, again, just ef.
Yeah.
With the devastating threat of rook e1 check.
I mean, the mistakes and inaccuracies are coming thick and fast, according to the machine, but you can see why they're playing these moves.
Well, it's got white as winning now anyway, because after knight, it recommends knight f8 there, but it's still got white 2.5 pawns up, despite the fact that it's actually 2 pawns down. So that's a compensation of 4.5 pawns.
The next move.
Well, I think the situation is just desperate for black, and he's looking for ways to try and, you know,
get his rook into the game, amongst other things.
Get his rook into the game.
So e5, queen g4, queen e3. Black is simply suffering because his rook on h8 is not playing.
Yeah.
White emphasizes that.
Yeah, stops any play with h3.
And now it's the slow motion stuff so far.
I just want to take the pawn on c6.
Just black simply feeling the lack of the rook.
Yeah. Queen h6, queen f3. We're into the territory now of, well, it's absolutely desperate for black because bishop takes c6 is threatened.
Bishop on d6 is just killing him, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
So bishop c6 is just a wipeout, isn't it?
Yeah.
So f6, that's really desperate now. Tries to get a haven for his king, but...
that's all the pawns recovered.
And the attack maintained.
Yeah.
And now another nice move with this bishop. Very nice manoeuvres with the bishop.
And now
it's
gone a piece up.
Mm.
I mean, I did think that was quite a nice game. If it had been played in the old days before they had computers, then we wouldn't have seen the inaccuracies. You know, but
it would just appear quite logical, wouldn't it? White Saxon.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was a practical game by Ferrugia, wasn't it? He put the pressure on black by sacrificing, and now report's got to defend.
Yeah.
And maybe that's not what he's best at, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's a classic example of just not castling early enough.
However, it was a nice, decisive game. And, I don't know what you'd think about the standard of play in that game overall. Is Kramnik right about the overall standard of play? Or
I would have thought
harsh.
Kramnik is probably in a better situation to judge than I am. I mean, I just thought it was very good. If we're showing students the importance of castling, that was an excellent example.
Yeah.
You know, so, and then the two Duda losses, you know, these are, again, very good teaching material because they show the danger of opening a file in front of your king, like the H file.
Mm.
And, you know, so there's plenty of teaching material, so I'm quite happy.
Well, I don't know whether you're happy about the next game because it features your tournament favourite, Hikaru Nakamura.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I like down the plug hole against Timo Radjimov.
We've got this variation again. Yeah, but Nakamura is playing. He's had four decisive games, hasn't he?
Let's have a look. Only two. Yeah.
Well, he beat Radjimov as well, didn't he?
Two decisive games, one win, one loss, and the rest
must be more. There's more. because he...
I've got this cross table here.
And you've got the up-to-date cross table?
Well, after round nine, yeah.
Right, really?
Five draws. Hang on, what's going on here?
It doesn't feel right, that. I'm sure he's got more...
It doesn't look right. I've got the chess base report in front of me. It says standings after round nine.
He's got four decisive games because he's played two double rounds. The 0-1 and 1-0 are actually four games and not two.
Okay. Well, in that case, the cross table is a bit difficult to read. I apologise.
It sort of looks like 1-0 is he won the game. Right, where in fact it's a one in one of his double rounds and a zero in the other.
Right, well, let's crack on with this game and to say spare my blushes. So we're gonna it's a C3.
Yeah,
and this time black castles.
Yeah, castles D5.
Okay, so this is a different kettle of fish now, isn't it?
Yeah, knight BD2. D takes E4, D takes E4. And our old friend, a push of the A-pawn, which seems to just be all the rage in the computer era.
So just one thing, if he takes this pawn.
Yeah, well, this...
You take him with the queen.
Take the other pawn as well.
Well, you take him with the queen.
Yeah, and the issue is that when White's played C3, he doesn't have that square for his knight.
True.
So, and he's now threatening bishop takes f2 check, for example.
Yes, you give black too much freedom there.
Yeah.
So knight bd2, no chance of that.
Yeah.
And pawn now, takes pawn, pawn takes pawn. And now this our old friend a5.
A5, our yeah. Hello, darkness, our old friend.
You're driving me around the bend. Okay, a5.
And the
I guess that's a stop b4.
Well, yeah, presumably, you know.
Okay, well, I mean, I'm going to take this off. Come on, let's be greedy.
Right. Show me the money. That is brave.
Yeah, but it's not my game, so I can afford to be brave.
Right. So what happens if now you play?
You got queen e8. Gets the pawn back. Or maybe it doesn't.
Rook e8. Knight takes c6, queen d6.
He doesn't care.
Yeah, queen takes c6. Bishop b7.
Oh my God.
That wasn't meant to happen.
Well, you can always take an f6.
I can take on f6.
I can claim Marshall Gambit like.
Go on, play knight b3. Make my day. I just better explain that for the readers, because the old master has seen that this is a checkmating combination.
And Nakamura heads straight to YouTube. Explain it to 5 billion fans.
Yeah, hello. Well, this is how I've been read about in 14 moves.
Right, let's go back.
Yeah, okay.
So A5, clearly tempting White into grabbing that very hot pawn.
Yeah.
Queen to C2.
Yeah, very, very politely declined by Mr. Regibov.
I would say it's necessary to defend that pawn now. So this is why Queen E7 was played.
Yeah, and then White A4. Goes pawn to A4. Then we get knight a7.
That's a very weird move.
Yeah. Stockfish approves. But, well, I suppose...
Bishop d7, maybe, is that far too modest for the present era?
Well, maybe knight b8. I mean, you know, knight b8 and c6 and knight
b8. Yeah, that's certainly... Bishop g4 must also be possible.
Looks very Breyer-like. But I like the tacit offer of a draw here, bishop b2, knight c6, which is refused. So Regibov also wants to get back in the
game. They want to play for a win, don't they?
Well, when you're white, you are.
It's come to the point where Regibov needs to win.
Yeah. So now,
back he goes.
A7, bishop b5, and then, well, then that a pawn. I mean, I'm sorry Nakamura lost, but it was gratifying at least to see one of these a5 pawns being removed from the board. You know, because there's a point at which this sort of thing should be discouraged. Now, he needs to protect with bishop b6. Right. And
I guess you just play knight d2 again. It's a weird game. Both players go up and down, to and fro.
Well, then you can repeat. Can you repeat with bishop?
I might play knight c4 then. Bishop takes knight, knight c4. No, bishop a6. Yeah, probably lead to a draw by
I prefer knight b8. I don't know about you. A4, what's wrong with knight b8? Intending c6 and knight bd7.
Well, nothing.
Where we've got our stuff protected and in good shape, and then the bishop can float to c7. And you've got your e5 pawn well protected. All according to Steinitz. But we have a show, of course. So, bishop g4. Bishop takes e6. So, Stockfish is... I pre-annotated these games using Stockfish and on HiArc's Chess Explorer Pro. And this is where these notes come from, right? But it always looks kind of patronizing to me when Stockfish gives a move an exclamation mark, as is to say, well done, human. You played a decent move for a change.
The pawn is officially removed.
Yeah.
Now, he could go bishop takes f2 check.
Yeah, but that would be like hugely...
How lousy is that? Let's see.
It's going to be, well, what, queen takes f2 and bishop g5 or something.
Let's have a look. Let's have a look. How lousy is this?
Meanwhile, there's going to be a b4 as well.
So white has got a very superior endgame.
Well, he's got a passed a pawn and an attack on the king side. So you think, well, you know, that should stretch the defence.
Got to do that
beyond breaking point. B4.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I'm not thrilled. I'm not thrilled, Nigel. I'm not thrilled.
Okay. King H1.
Not only have you got positional pressure, you've got tactical pressure as well. Yeah. Okay, well, white is just clearly better there. Yeah. So the A pawn is removed.
Yeah, and from what I could see, then black never had enough compensation for this quite serious strategic concession. So he plays like knight h5 and, you know, looking to play, get some kingside play. Goes king h8 to play f5.
Now king h1, nice move.
Yeah. H6, rook g1.
Of course, what you can expect from Nakamura is a tremendous fight.
Oh, yeah, he's not going to cave in. Yeah, a lot of these moves are getting mildly criticised, but black is certainly trying to develop activity. So, well, queen d5 is, not a very nice move to have to play. You know, you're seeking the exchange of queens when white has got this monster passed a pawn.
And black's got a knight on h5.
Yeah.
All the same. Interesting move that, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just avoiding...
Allowing c5. Pawns. But he allows c5.
Yeah. But, you know, when this a-pawn gets to a6 and even a7, then that is more or less the end of the road.
Yeah. So the knight rushes across to assist. Pawn gets to a7. King to g8. Now, according to the machine and looking at it from a human point of view...
Well, he could reduce his disadvantage to plus 4.23. You know, so
I guess I just go Rook B2, do I?
Yeah, Rook B2. Apparently, Rook B1 is good as well.
Just hold the fort.
Yeah.
Followed by bringing the king up, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, is it so easy? Is it so easy?
Well, let's do Rook B1 instead of Rook B2, just to hold the e pawn as well, and then you want to bring the king up.
Well, I guess black brings the king across. Oh, and I can't even bring the king across. Knight E7 check.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, anybody could see that it's not that easy for a black.
Yeah, it's just it's completely tied up because
Rook
of the
A8 is out of the game.
Yeah. I mean, I think that Nakamura can't be happy that his position right out of the opening became so bad.
Okay. No, what's happened here?
Have we gone to the end of a variation there?
Yeah, it looks like.
I think we have.
1 second. There's a hell of a lot of notes, aren't there?
Yeah, that's what happens when you stockfishify a game.
Interesting way of putting it.
Well, I thought I would do that, you know, just so we've got like some indication of what was going on.
So that seems like the right place for White's rook.
Yeah.
King comes up, knight comes back, hitting C7. C5.
C5 does not appear to help an awful lot, but what else can he do? C pawn is attacked.
Well,
he's got no moves, has he?
Go back here.
Yeah.
That's why Rook D5 was recommended, wasn't it? To get the rook into the game.
Yeah, so yeah.
He could try and tie down. I mean, the C-file is definitely the correct place for white rooks.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Well, that move is a killer because then he's got not just one pass pawn on the seventh. It's getting a friend on the sixth.
Well, this is horrible now. Look at that.
Yeah.
Good technique, though.
Oh, yeah. Very good technique. I mean, all the players from former Soviet countries have got, like, just, you know, they're almost always good in the endgame. You know, they were very systematically trained. And,
well, one-sided from a certain point on, can we isolate the point at which it got bad?
Yeah, well, it was. If we go back
here,
yeah. I mean, I didn't
here.
Yeah, here.
Just bishop B6.
This is where black should play bishop B6. Sure about knight A7. I don't know. I don't know if you can do better. A4. Then I just want to play knight b8, c6, and knight bd7. When the position makes more sense to me.
Bishop on b5. Okay, so let me try something like this.
Yeah, we'll go c6.
Now, where are we going to put this guy? Well, that makes a lot of sense. It's a Philidor-like position, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know.
Maybe it goes to c4, so white can look to play knight h4. But I don't see why this should be so terrible for black. You know, white's not improving.
I'm not sure about knight h4. I mean, you've probably got to come back if you do that now.
Well, yeah. And then black will probably... Or maybe you can do knight h5. knight h5 or something. You could also put this bishop back on c7 in, maybe not here, but in some situations, and then be able to play knight c5 and bishop e6.
Well, then maybe bishop here is just slightly more active.
Yeah, yeah. So then we can do knight c5.
Yeah.
And, developing.
Oh dear.
So might need to watch like b3 and bishop a3, but you know, but I'm sure there are decent moves for black in that position.
Yeah,
but I thought the black's pieces went to kind of funny squares.
Not a7.
A7 looks very strange, because the best thing you can then do with the knight is put it back on c6.
And now white initiates a sequence which gives him the advantage by force, doesn't he?
Yeah. And this position, I would say, black is probably already close to losing. You know, because the a pawn is a permanent factor. And, you know, it doesn't look like black's going to be able to conjure enough play on the king side to compensate for it.
Well, I mean, he's a pawn down as much as anything else.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's a pawn.
Yeah. And a pass pawn, a supported pass pawn. You know, so...
Well, at least we've had some decisive games. It's not as it's not as if, you know...
A lot of good teaching material.
Yes.
You know, getting castled, not opening files in front of your king. Maybe Kramnik's right.
So how do you see the tournament finishing up? Nepomniachtchi on 6.5, Caruana 5.5, and then...
Well, yeah, Nepomniachtchi is obviously going to be very difficult to displace from that position now. He's in a commanding lead. I think second place could go to anyone. I mean, obviously, Caruana has to be the favourite to come second. But I think that's opened up quite a bit, you know, because there's a few players now who aren't that far away. And if somebody, you know, starts winning some games...
Maybe
Ding. I think Ding might finish strongly.
Yeah.
You know, he could be the surprise, you know, to come second and, you know, edge out Caruana.
Yeah, he needs a bit of Dong to get him going.
Yeah. And, yeah, so it's, I mean, I do think, though, because of all the mistakes, because there have been quite a few mistakes, right, and a lot of decisive games, that it is more entertaining than I would have expected.
Yeah.
You know, the games are, you know, having your king caught in the center and then, you know, getting checkmated and stuff like that, you know, that's not what you'd normally expect to see at this level.
The big question is, of course, will Magnus Carlsen play any of them?
Well, it might. I have a suspicion that when push comes to shove, and when he sees that, say Nepomniachtchi qualifies to play for the World Championship, right, or he's in the frame at the end, then Carlsen might think, oh my goodness, my title might go to this guy that I beat so heavily the last time. And he might be tempted to defend just on those grounds alone.
Well, we shall see.
Yeah.
And it will all be revealed within the next week who's going to be his challenger.
Yeah. And then I don't know how long Carlsen has to decide. I mean, he should really be ready with a quick decision so that they then know where they all stand. I actually think he should have said before the tournament, you know, but that he was either going to defend or not going to defend, so that then they would know what was at stake.
Thing is, everybody understands that he's the best player by quite some distance.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's held the title for quite a long time now.
Yeah.
I can understand why he might not want to do it.
Yeah. But I think it might be a sign that he's losing his appetite for competition in general.
Well, he simply plays too much, doesn't he?
Well, it could
playing be. Playing online all the time, bullet blitz, all this stuff, you know. It's like... It's exhausting. It will exhaust you, won't it?
Yeah. So he might start to go off the boil a bit anyway.
You're just totally saturated with chess. You want to do something else. You're desperate to do something else, yeah. Even if you're the best player in the world.
Yeah. Windsurfing.
Poker.
Poker. Something, you know, but just get off the roundabout.
Yeah.
I get why he doesn't want to do it, or maybe he wants to take like a back seat, maybe play less. Don't know if he's got any hobbies, but he probably doesn't have time for them. But a hobby is always good.
But he likes things like football and tennis and all these sort of things. I should think he's got enough money to do what he wants.
Yeah, yeah,
you know, without any problems whatsoever. So, I mean, I do get it. I mean, he's clearly the best player. Everybody knows this. And, I mean, I think, honestly, a match against Caruana or Nakamura, they're the only two people who can give him a game. I don't see Nepomniachtchi giving him a game in the next match, if it takes place.
Yeah, yeah. Those two would provide...
He's got him psyched out.
Yeah. I think there's other players, too, who would give him an interesting match. I think Giri might be an interesting opponent for Carlsen, but he's not in the tournament, of course.
No.
You know, and if you have anybody, any two players apart from Carlsen in the top, you know, then it could go either way. You know, I mean, I still sort of think that Caruana is the one most likely to succeed Carlsen. But his qualification now is in doubt.
Well, we'll see. The next week will reveal all.
Yeah. So next Tuesday it will have to be, because on Wednesday I'm getting inoculated against various dread diseases that might occur in India, like diphtheria and whatever. So yes, are you good for Tuesday?
Are we going to run the show whilst you're in Chennai?
Well, we'll do some pre-recordings.
Nigel is going to Chennai to be the team coach of the Barbados women's team.
Yeah, we wish them well.
Yeah. We hope they're going to beat the Russian team into submission with all the latest dirty tricks. Nigel's toolbox, which is just that is if he survives the jabs.
If I survive the experience, right? I'm you know. So
we'll be back next week.
Yeah,
on Tuesday at 10:30.
Yep. Thanks very much for watching, everyone.
Cheerio.
Okay, bye.
Ciao.